I'll just start briefly with some housekeeping remarks and some context, and then we have an introductory speaker, and we'll invite our panelists up onto the stage, and we'll be going for the next 90 minutes. So first of all, thank you for coming to this event, part of the 10th Annual European Development Days, and I especially want to thank our partner Philips, without whom we would not be having this event. And we're trying to make it as interactive as possible. So I want to encourage you to participate in the Q&A element of the session. There's also going to be some live polling. So I'll indicate when you should turn on your app, and we'll get you to respond to three or four critical questions. And of course, you can also make contributions online if you use the tag EDD. Politico 16, so EDD Politico 16. We can take your questions and build your contributions in that way. Some very quick context. This morning's debate is about Sustainable Development Goal 3. So that's around ensuring healthy lives and promoting well-being at all ages. Now, we've had much progress, yes, in improving life expectancy. There are 17,000 fewer children who die each day than in 1990. But that's just one of the examples where there's still a lot more to be done. There's 6 million children who die before their fifth birthday. 4 out of 5 deaths of children under 5 are in Saharan Africa and Southern Asia. The maternal mortality ratio in developing regions is still 14 times higher than in developed regions. HIV remains the leading cause of death for women of reproductive age. So, what are we trying to do? There's obviously a range of finance, infrastructure, and skills challenges, but the specific goal is around achieving universal health coverage, including financial risk protection, access to quality healthcare services, and access to safe, effective, quality, and affordable essential medicines and vaccines for all. On that note, I would like to welcome up to the stage for our opening keynote, Ronald de Jong, the Executive Vice President and Chief Market Leader for Royal Philips. Take it away, Ronald.
Thank you very much, Ryan. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning, and welcome to this debate on sustainable healthcare for all by 2030. A shared effort for a common goal. Traditionally, addressing societal challenges has been the exclusive domain of the public sector, NGOs and donors. But since the launch of the Sustainable Development Goals, there are two new stakeholder groups that have an active role to play in the realization of the Sustainable Development Goals: youth and the private sector. The debate today will be about joining forces between the public sector, the private sector, but also between the various parties in the private sector to make sure that we make progress towards the goal of leaving nobody behind and ensuring that everybody on the planet will have access to high-quality healthcare at a cost that is affordable to society. At Philips, we believe that everybody in society has a big role to play and a huge responsibility to make the world a better place. We have translated that into our highest goal, which is to improve lives of people based upon meaningful innovation and make the world healthier and more sustainable. As a matter of fact, the highest goal of our company is not expressed in terms of revenue growth or in terms of return on investment. Our highest goal is to improve the lives of 3 billion people a year by the year 2025. Based upon the work that we do. And we believe that if we do that successfully, we will also be a very interesting partner to invest in, and we will be financially successful. I consider that a paradigm shift, and I encourage many other private companies to think along the same line. Years ago, our company started to transform and align its business objectives and strategies and policies with some of the key challenges that we saw society was facing, whether that was in driving energy efficiency and reducing CO2 footprint, that we have been trying to address via our lighting business, driving the revolution of replacing incandescent lighting, which is very energy inefficient, with LED lighting, which allows up to 80% of savings. But in the field of healthcare, we have said, if we look at what is happening on the planet, We currently have 7 billion people living on the planet. That number is expected to go up to at least 9 billion people by the year 2050. People become older, life expectancy is on the rise, and elderly people in 90% of the cases suffer from chronic diseases. How are we going to take care of all those people that will require care? Reality is that today, there's still a lot of people left behind. That is the reality. Still, more than 800 women die every day from preventable causes related to pregnancy and childbirth. 99% of these women live in developing countries, and more than half of them live in sub-Saharan Africa. We see that 6 million people died under the age of 5 last year. Half of them were newborns. So when we have the ambition to leave nobody behind, we still have a lot of work to do. And I think when it comes to the Sustainable Development Goals, and especially Sustainable Development Goal 3, we have made a pretty big commitment to address that challenge and do it together. At Philips, we believe that we should start with strengthening primary healthcare in communities. We feel that building stronger, more resilient communities and giving communities access to primary care will be one of the cornerstones of the realization of Sustainable Development Goal 3, which is also the debate of today. That's why we work together with many parties also on the podium today to join forces and set up what we call community life centers, basic healthcare infrastructure in communities, very often even in off-grid areas where there is no access to electricity, where we use solar power to make sure that those communities have access to basic care. We have started our first community life center in Kiambu County, Kenya, 2 years ago. And we recently announced, in collaboration with, amongst others, the UNFPA, that we will set up a similar center in Mandera County, also in Kenya. What is a community life center? Community life center is a holistic concept addressing the elements such as improved service delivery, robust infrastructure, and capability development. And we do that through community engagement because we believe that that is key. Essential here is also the leverage of technology, especially digital technology, because that enables that we have support systems also for secondary and tertiary care levels. Since the first 18 months after the start of the Life Center in Kiambu County, we have seen very impressive results. We have seen that the number of children treated quadrupled in the period under review. And we also saw that the number of women taking the 4 recommended antenatal visits went up with a factor 16. We have been, as a consequence, saving lives. And I think that is something that we take pride in, but that we could never have done alone. We could only have done that by teaming up with parties. Now, the key challenge, and that is also something that I would like to trigger the panelists to discuss and debate, is how we get away from individual best practices, from pilot projects, from test situations, and scale those type of examples to impact. Because if we want to provide sustainable healthcare to all in only a couple of years, till 2030, then we need to scale. And we believe that there are 3 elements that will be critical to drive scale. First of all, it is to leverage the possibilities of modern technology. And I'm specifically referring to digital technology and connectivity. It's interesting to see that due to the digital revolution, many health systems in especially developing countries learn from the West, but leapfrog. And that is exactly what we need. We need leapfrogging in emerging countries where the challenges are highest to make sure that we provide access to care. At Philips, we recently launched an indicator. We call it the Future Health Index, which is an indicator to make clear how ready health systems and countries are to cope with the challenges of SDG 3. And what we see is that in emerging countries, there's a far higher adoption rate of digital technologies and connectivity than in mature countries. Whilst in mature countries and developed world, access to care is already at a pretty high level. Leveraging digital technology constitutes a formidable opportunity to leapfrog, and we should use that opportunity. There's one, innovation. The second element has a lot to do with partnerships. And I already referred to the importance of partnerships in order to address the key challenges in society. I'm very happy that some of our best partners are on stage today. We work actively together with them to see whether we can align our policies, our practices, and our strategies to make a breakthrough in providing access to care. Partnerships are key. We recently announced a partnership with Grand Challenges Canada. They provided us with a conditional grant to de-risk our investment in product development. We've developed what we call a child automated respiratory monitor, CHARM. And that device, which is a pretty simple, straightforward device, allows you to detect pneumonia. Pneumonia is one of the largest causes of death with young children. It's bigger than HIV/AIDS, TB, and malaria combined. So with the help of Grand Challenges China, we were able to prevent quite some childhood death. And we are currently working with partners to see how we can also scale that to impact. Another example, which I'm personally also very proud of in my capacity as chairman of the Philips Foundation, which is an independent charity, is the Dutch Coalition for Humanitarian Innovation. Launched by Minister Ploumen, and where we work together on innovating solutions for humanitarian challenges the world is faced with. We're also exploring partnerships with the Global Fund, and Mark is present here today, to see, with support of the Dutch government, whether we can help to innovate and strengthen health systems across the globe. Partnerships is the second important element next to digital innovation in order to make progress versus sustainable development goal number 3. And then the third one, and maybe the most complex one, is can we find the right business models, the right models of engaging with each other, the right financing models to make sure that we align interests of all parties involved in function of what we try to accomplish, which is making sure that we leave nobody behind. Huge investments in primary healthcare will be required, especially in the context of the ambition to realize universal health coverage for all. This will require different ways of collaboration, risk pooling in public-private partnerships, different roles, both by governments, NGOs, donor organizations, and also companies like ourselves in the private sector. Ladies and gentlemen, let me come to a close and go to the real important part of this morning, which is the discussion. We believe that the Sustainable Development Goals provide a very clear compass and a shared agenda for improving the lives of people around the world, starting with those that are most in need. We also believe that in order to realize that goal, we have to think differently. We will have to challenge our own paradigms. We will have to see radical transformation of predominantly primary healthcare systems at a community level. And we feel that there are three elements critical to do so. Leverage digital technology to leapfrog, establish partnerships, and find the right business and financing models based upon shared values. I think, ladies and gentlemen, that the world is changing for the better, given the insight that has been growing, I would say, that no party can do this alone. It is no longer the exclusive domain of the public sector or donor organizations or NGOs to address global challenges. We very much feel committed to that as a company, and I know many other companies do as well. So let's take our responsibility. Really interested to hear the panel's view on this subject. And Ryan, I would like to give back to you to introduce the panelists, and I'm looking forward to a very engaged discussion. Thank you very much.
I if I could now invite the panelists to come up onto the stage, and I'll give you a very warm introduction once you're up here and people can see who you are. Okay, so if I can go from left to right, and I think I'm going to get it right. So on my right and your left, we have Elsa Zecking, who's a young leader with the European Development Days. Then next to her, we have Mark Deibel, who is the Executive Director of the Global Fund. Then we have Christian Rebergen, who is stepping in for Lilian Ploumen, who is the Dutch minister who was unable to join us this morning, but he's the Director General for International Cooperation at the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Then we have Martin Seychelles, the Deputy Director General at DG Sante at the European Commission. Next to him, Martha Rojas-Orego, who's the Head of Global Advocacy for Care International. And then Bob Collymore, the CEO of Safaricom. So, we will have a few minutes of introductory thoughts from each of the speakers and then get right into debate. But if I could start with you, Christian, to prompt discussion. I know that your minister and your department have been very, very involved in the idea that partnerships are the way forward to really solve these issues. So I was wondering if you could tell us a bit about one of the partnerships that is working well in your mind.
Well, thank you. And yeah, my minister had to be in a press conference at 10, so I had to excuse her for that. She would love to be here because, well, the subject and especially the way of working in public-private partnership is very close to what she thinks is important for the new SDGs agenda. I think one of the examples is, and I always mention it, is what we called the public-private partnership in the health insurance funds. This actually is a fund based on the fact that, for instance, in Africa, more than 50% of all healthcare is provided by the private sector. Whether you like it or not, whether you have strong political views or not, that's the reality. So we have to cope with it and we have to deal with it. And also with the fact that many people really fall below the poverty level once they are confronted with illnesses and sickness. So then they have to do, yes, huge expenses. So what can help? I mean, we know in our Western situation that we have insurances for that, and which is, of course, not a very simple system. You have to pay in advance for expenses you don't really know. But the good thing is, of course, that there's a system of solidarity. So we've put in, let's say, a few hundred million euros, and this fund then started to develop an insurance system, both in Nigeria and in other countries. In Nigeria, we started in Kwara State, and now the government of Nigeria says, well, this has worked. We now have to get to scale and let's spread it out all over Nigeria. Talking about, let's say, scale, Mr. De Jong, as you were referring to, how can we scale up? Well, imagine if a system like that would work in whole Nigeria. But once you have, let's say, you pay premium, you also have to see, you want to have healthcare to be delivered in good quality. So we also started to invest in healthcare facilities. Well, and for healthcare facilities, especially for the what we call the small and medium providers, they're often confronted with the fact they have no access to finance. So we started a small credit fund, both public money, private money, and for the bigger investment, but basically done through the Farm Access NGO, started an investment fund. And this investment fund was really to big capital to invest in bigger hospitals and insurance companies. And this model has worked. It's difficult to get people acquainted with the idea to pay the premiums. But if you have selected groups and you have good insurance companies where you can invest in, and now I'm also happy to say that this model has been awarded a special prize by the Financial Times. I'm looking to my colleague. It isn't, especially for as a more very innovative model for. So this is just one example.
Yeah. And how big is it? How many people do you have involved?
Well, I think a few hundred million. I mean, that's what we're aiming for. I think now in Kwara State, a few hundred thousand, and it's not just in Nigeria, because it's also, we try to do it in Kenya and in Tanzania. But once we can scale up, well, we are sure we should provide much more more people. Okay.
Excellent, thank you. Now, Mark, if I can bring you into the conversation, we're looking to how we can get universal healthcare for all, but you've been more involved in sort of disease and condition-focused approaches. So can you tell us what is the contribution that that laser-like focus makes to the broader thing that we're trying to attain?
So thanks, it's a great question. And it's great to be part of this panel because actually the Global Fund was created as a 21st century partnership. So it's not people in Geneva, it's actually everyone represented here, the people who give us money, like the Dutch government, European Commission, the other side, Commissioner Mimica actually announced a very large contribution for us. The private sector, we're one of the few organizations that has private sector voting members of our board, and civil society voting members of our board, and increasingly youth, which is hugely important, which I'll come back to. So the 15 years ago, if you looked at it, we needed to get involved and do something because the HIV, TB, and malaria epidemics were destroying countries, literally destroying countries, families, communities, and nations. I mean, if you looked in some areas, 75% of pregnant women were HIV positive, which means they were going to die, 75% of pregnant women. The estimates on the economy and the damage to the economy was extraordinary. But I think the biggest harm to all of this was hopelessness. You went into communities and it was just utter hopelessness. And if you're in a hopeless community, why would you invest in education? Why would you try to get a job? Why would you do anything if you think you're gonna die and your entire family is going to die? So we needed to get in and reverse that. And it's happened. So we're on the right side of the tipping point in all three of the diseases. We can actually get to the end of these epidemics by 2030, which is extraordinary if you think about it. I mean, TB and malaria have been around since recorded medical history, thousands of years. This can be the generation. This can be the generation that ends these epidemics, and HIV is the modern plague. And we can bring them under control. We have the science, we have the investments, and we have the ability to do it. And it's happened by partnership. But the Sustainable Development Goals, and this beautiful pin actually represents them, actually calls on us to do something different, which is not focus on diseases, focus on human beings. And what does a human being need? Now, one of the things they need is health, but you have to link it to other component pieces, including human rights issues, and I'll come back to that in a second, but also linking sectors. So one of the areas we're very engaged in right now is linking education and health. The two fundamental pieces for development are education and health. Ask any business person, they need educated, healthy people to work for them and to buy their stuff. And economies don't grow if you don't have healthy, educated people. And this is particularly true for girls and women, where we're involved in some fascinating public-private partnerships to actually drive economic opportunity for girls and women. Because we will win or lose the fight against HIV in Southern Africa, which means globally, based on whether or not we have a gender-equal world. In fact, we will succeed or fail in the Sustainable Development Goals based on whether or not we have a gender-equal world. We can't get any of the SDGs if we don't have a gender-equal world. But the fundamental piece of engaging in HIV, TB, and malaria is building resilient and sustainable systems for health, which is a new part of our strategy, and engaging in human rights. Why human rights? Well, HIV and TB are very unique diseases. If a Zika-carrying mosquito were flying around here, all of us would be equally susceptible to it. Unless you're a pregnant woman, in which case it's a little bit different. HIV and TB prey on discrimination. They prey on the most marginal and vulnerable people in the world. And so we actually can't get to the end of HIV and tuberculosis unless we become better human beings, unless we engage in human rights. And actually, Minister Plumman had a great piece in The Guardian today on precisely this issue, and I would encourage everyone to take a look at it. So that's a pretty unique set of circumstances we need to engage in. And then resilient and sustainable systems for health, and we're very clear on systems for health. The goal is not to build a system. If your goal is to build a system, you might or might not get health. The goal is to focus on that person in the most distal part of a community and get health to them. Get education to them. And that means linking the traditional sector, health sector, with the community. Because if you're not engaging in the community, if you're not engaging with youth, you're not going to do prevention, you're not going to identify the vulnerable, you're not going to get them into services, you're not going to keep them into services, and you're not going to have healthy people, communities, or nations. And that's something that, you know, what's happening with Philips, and that's why we're talking with them about what we could do, is so exciting. Same with Safaricom. Use digital technology. Use mHealth, reach people through whatever tools you can to reach them. We have something called an innovation hub to try to bring all this together. But I want to end on the human rights piece and the vulnerable get to people in the community piece, because that's how we're going to end HIV, TB, and malaria, but it's also how we're going to become better human beings. And we are at a very unique moment in history. We're at a time when everything is in flux. People are on the move in a way they never have been. I'm not talking about refugees, I'm talking about normal migratory patterns. TB is a threat to this part of the world, not because of refugees. TB and multi-drug resistant TB is a threat to this part of the world because of normal migratory patterns. The world is on the move in a very different way, and we're connected in a remarkably different way. The economic and political power bases in the world are changing in a very rapid way, and that leads to uncertainty. Massive uncertainty. And historically, if you look at history, when we are in that type of period, there is a tendency to look inward and backward. And we have thousands of examples in history of when we look inward and backward, we mess things up really badly. And it usually takes a while for us to go through some really bad period before we correct and begin to look outward and forward. And that's the thing about whether it's human rights or looking at the youth or looking at whether or not communities stay together, and whether or not partnerships come together to support people in unique ways. If we look backward and inward, we will fail in ending epidemics, we will fail in providing health, we will fail as a people. If we look outward and forward and work together, we will solve the HIV, TB, malaria epidemics, we will build resilient and sustainable systems for health, we will become better people. And whether it's what happened in Orlando or anywhere else, this can be an individual looking inward and rejecting others, people who are different. It can be a national rejecting others who are different. If we do that, we will fail. If we come together, and that's partnership on every level, not just public-private partnerships, on every human level, we will succeed, not only in health, not only in education, not only in the sustainable development goals, we'll succeed as a world and as a people.
Thank you, Mark. I find those words very, very powerful. Elsa, if I can bring you in now. You're someone who not only saw the effects of Ebola in Guinea, you were also directly involved in helping to mitigate them. Can you tell us a little bit about, talk us through those experiences and how that got to sort of the points you were telling me about earlier, that we can't just have disease-driven approaches, that really not much works without a universal platform underneath it.
All right, thank you very much, Ryan, for that. And I am very grateful to be participating on this panel. Now, picking up on a lot of the comments that Mark has said, which are very strong comments, I would like to start off by saying that I believe that we have to move from a more disease-centered approach to a more holistic care approach and a more healthcare system strengthening. Now, I'm not saying that we should eradicate all the disease programs that we're doing, but more so move on from looking vertically to also understanding the whole healthcare system. Now, like Ryan has just mentioned, in May 2015, I deployed to Guinea and I spent 6 weeks at the Ebola treatment unit in Koya. And one of the striking things that got to me was, we worked Monday to Sunday, 12 to 14 hour days, and we often lost track of time or what day it was. While the physical and emotional toll was apparent, I still felt very lucky, and I felt very lucky because I had easy access to diagnostics in the event we felt ill, which often was the case. A couple of the group members fell ill, but at least we knew that even if we felt ill, we had easy access to diagnostics. But in addition to that, we also had the reassurance that in the event we actually got ill, we could eventually be moved out of the country. Now, this whole experience really got me thinking about the healthcare system. And this is only because an efficient healthcare system is not one that can respond to an emergency. An efficient healthcare system is an everyday system that can spot an emergency. Because if they cannot spot an emergency, that's exactly the case that happened with the Ebola outbreak. It took over 4 months to actually spot an emergency, and the ripple effects, we can all testify to what the ripple effects were. So, a lot of questions came to mind, one of which was, imagine that it was a faster spreading virus like influenza A. I mean, I'm currently in the final year of my PhD and I'm working on influenza, and I know how fast the virus can spread. We were actually lucky that it was something like Ebola, and I say lucky because we can easily say, well, if you stay there and I stay here, we can stop the spread of the disease. Now, if it's influenza or if it's TB and they're all viral particles that travel through the air and the healthcare system cannot spot it, we're in a global village, really. So what is going to happen eventually, that whatever happens in a village in Guinea is as important and could easily reach the United States or Asia as essentially the case that happened. So one of the things which I really like to focus on as well was encouraging the partners within these communities or who have pledged to go out and help within these outbreaks to actually implement and follow through. We had several incidents where certain partners delayed in their response to incidents that happened within the outbreak. And I don't believe that this should be the case. Incidents that could have been solved within a two-hour meeting took 4 days, took eight-hour meetings, took threats, took us having to reach out to our bosses either in the UK or Germany. And this really got me distraught. I was greatly disappointed when I got back, and I had to tell that to my supervisor because I thought, this is not the world we should be living in, and this is not how things should be happening. And I really understood then that's how we got to where we got to with the Ebola outbreak. And now we can sit back and focus on every individual disease. But when I look forward at, or when I look back at the lessons learned from the HIV/AIDS epidemic, and I look at the lessons learned from the Ebola outbreak, they're more or less the same. So then my question is, are we really learning and implementing, or are we just talking and policy making? How much groundwork is actually being done, and how much is actually trickling into the society? And all the funding which has been provided, which we're very grateful for, how much is really being absorbed by the country? And also, is this sustainable? Are we going for a short-term needs-based, or are we going for a rights-based, long-term sustainable? After the Ebola outbreak, what has happened now? What is the state of these countries after the Ebola outbreak? Can they sustain themselves? Now, it's easy to fall back and say, well, it's a national level or it's a government problem. And of course, we understand that. I'm not oblivious to the fact that initial response should occur from the government's level or initially before pushing on to the international response, because then we have this problem of reliance on foreign aid. But then I'm also saying that, how is the international community pushing the government to hold them responsible and accountable for their duties to their to their countries in the respect of health?
Thank you so much, Elsa. Now, Martin, if I can make a slightly unusual analogy to introduce you. I think of the EU, and at least in a European context, the private sector, somewhat non-traditional actors in the health sector. You don't have huge legal competences. You have to work with lots of other departments to make things happen across all these silos and borders. So I just wanted to get your view on what's the role of those less traditional actors in making healthcare happen globally, and how are you trying to make that happen from the Commission?
Yes, well, that's a very interesting question, because it's at the heart of the debate we're having in Europe right now. As you know, in Europe, traditionally, we've had a very public sector-driven approach to health for historical and obvious reasons, because health has always been considered to be the basis of the social model, and we continue to believe that it is the basis of the social model. You cannot have equity, you cannot have social justice without also looking at things like access to healthcare, etc. So that remains a fundamental principle. Having said that, I think there's growing realization that we need to harness all the resources and energies and knowledge in society that exists. So this is too simply, it's too important just to restrict in a bureaucratic framework. Maybe also the crisis, that the economic crisis that Europe has gone through, has forced us also to look, to ask some deeper questions. So what is the role of health in the social and economic sphere? What is the role of health systems? I admit, a tendency that health systems sometimes became an end in themselves. You know, they always had kind of, at least until recently in Europe, certainly no problem to access resources, and therefore they were taken for granted. Now we're realizing we have to look at the outcomes, we have to understand also what role health plays as an investment. Now, the role of the various actors. Clearly, first thing, of course, it's important to ensure there is an effective dialogue between the various sectors, so we can understand also the various perspectives. And this is very important, because traditionally also, for example, when we look at things like public-private partnerships, in Europe, initially, there's always been some kind, sometimes in the public sector, some hesitation, because there was not a full understanding of the roles we could play. Bringing in other actors is important, first of all, because of some big challenges we are facing. We are facing globally, this is not just Europe, it's globally, the need to ensure appropriate levels of financing. Let me start. I mean, I know it's not just about the financing, But without resources, you cannot convert aspirations to reality. And that's a big challenge, because the needs are growing, you just heard, and we need to ensure that we now is not the time, really, to start to compromise all the achievements that we are on the verge of achieving. So bringing in innovative sources of financing is very important, but also it's the expertise that these actors can bring in. So the expertise in the private sector, how to manage projects, situations, etc., which is not maybe always the traditional strength of the public sector. The role of civil society, it was mentioned by speakers before me. Health systems are, of course, fundamental. You cannot have health without health systems. But health systems should not be, as I said before, a bureaucratic structure. You need to get the involvement of the community. They need to be designed by the community for the community. And that's important. And that's a very important aspect, because very often, as you know, a very important principle for the EU and globally, and this is reflected in our global approach, is that countries should have the ownership of their health systems and they need to take the decisions for themselves. But of course, that should not be done in isolation. Within the country, there is a need to ensure that health issues are part of a national dialogue and also that the health systems also look outwards. They cannot be insular. One thing we have definitely found to be very useful in Europe is the regional model of cooperation. And this is going to be extremely important, for example, for the middle-income countries as they develop, to also look beyond their borders and cooperate with neighbors, with other countries, because some of the issues they and we are all facing are simply too complex or too big to be faced by one single country alone. So, and here is another role where, that stakeholders can play, is all these actors can help bring about this coalition by identifying common issues, by advocacy, by mobilizing attention. And the final point I'd like to make is, it was mentioned also by other speakers before me, this balance between the issue-specific actions, where a lot of actors have traditionally focused their efforts, and the need to strengthen health systems. I don't see these as mutually exclusive or contradictory. The Ebola crisis has demonstrated, if we ever needed such a demonstration, that an individual crisis can really block a lot of other issues. It can bring a whole system to its knees very quickly. So, yes, we do need to pay attention to and continue to pay attention to these big issues, but we also need to work within, to strengthen health systems, to increase issues such as access, the resilience, the sustainability of health systems. This is true for Europe, this is true for any other part of the world. And I think this is also now reflected in the models of funding that we use. How do we find the balance between continuing to sustain important efforts that are on really at a tipping point, as we've just heard, but at the same time ensure that, for example, things like the implementation of the international health regulations are not forgotten, because without those, all these gains could easily be lost.
Thank you, Martin. Martha, if I can bring you in, we heard from Mark about the need for a gender-equal world. We heard from Martin around the fact that if the system isn't from the community and by the community, it won't work. Can you tell us a bit more about your approach to gender inequality and some of the other social factors that slow us down from getting to this goal of sustainable healthcare?
Thank you, Ryan. I'm going to share our learning as Care International, one of the biggest humanitarian and development organizations active for 70 years in more than 80 countries. So we have been working a lot in trying to get health outcomes. And I would say that our main learning is that direct service delivery alone or technological fixes does not make it. How can that work if, in many places, women are discriminated and don't have access to health? When girls are married at 12, 13 years, when there are inequalities that make it that they cannot even know what they have the right to do, when there is violence in their homes. So what we have learned is that in order to really get where we need in terms of health outcomes, we need to address these barriers of gender inequality, of social and cultural norms that block women to get access to health services and to rights. So this is our main learning, and we believe, we see that if we don't address that, we are not going to get our ambition of health care for all. And let me just illustrate with one example. We have been working for more than 10 years in Peru, close to my heart. I'm not Peruvian, I'm Colombian, but it's my region. And working in one of the most of the poorest communities, and in particular with a very marginalized group, women, indigenous women in Puno. What we found out is, of course, this is 2/3 of the population living under the poverty line, 1 out of 5 women delivering their babies without any medical support, while in the cities it's 2 in 3. 1 in 5 have access to, are able to read. And it was very interesting because we saw that even when the services were provided, the access was very limited. So we tried to understand why. So we did an assessment to try to understand the reasons. And there were many, including language. These women only spoke Quechua or Aymara. They were actually discriminated. They were considered dirty, stupid, not educated. Some of the cultural practices, like vertical child delivery, were not allowed. So they wouldn't go when even they had the possibility to do it. So what we did was to get together a group of women to become monitors of service quality. And they were called the vigilantes. So these are those who oversee the quality of service. And it's very interesting because this group of women who we trained started to have the role of going and seeing and assessing the quality of services. So they would discuss with the service providers, with the patients in their language, and try to help bridge this difference between those providing the services and what the needs of the women were. And the results were amazing. Because on the one hand side, of course, women started to go more to get the services that were offered. They were empowered, so we started to see women leaders who were not only leading on health, but also in their lives. We saw that the actual maternal death rates changed. Before, they were twice as much as the rest of the country. So we saw not only results in terms of empowering a marginalized group, but in actual results. So from this, what we clearly see is that if we are to get health for all by 2030, we will not do it if we don't look at the profound gender inequality, social, cultural norms, which are a barrier for women to get access to many of us here are providing in terms of funds, in terms of technologies, etc.
Thank you, Martha. Now, Bob, you run one of the leading telecommunications companies in Africa. We've heard from Ronald about the importance of digital innovations. We know that Kenya has been fantastic, for example, in being the global leader in M-payments and so on. What contribution can a company like you make to getting towards this goal?
I think, you know, when you run a mobile phone company, it could be the dullest thing in the world, because essentially we just sell air. But actually what
we're
we do
addicted
is...
addicted to your air. don't play it down.
We get to hang out with some interesting people, because if you start out with a purpose, then you will sell more than air. And, you know, we have more mobile phones in Africa than we've got toilets. And if you look at the doctor-to-patient ratio, it's shockingly low. So we look at the ubiquity of the mobile handset. And not, I don't mean by handset the smartphone. You don't actually have to have a smartphone. But we look at the ubiquity and we say, well, what can we do with this? And we've worked with partners. So we've worked with some of the partners here, you know, Care International. We've worked with World Vision, with AMREV, with Farm Access, with Philips, all coming together. And indeed, governments, because it's really important to get governments onto this. And often, sadly, governments tend to be the weakest link in this whole process. But we've worked with them all to kind of bolt together a number of different solutions. We've got solutions for maternal health care, for child care. Interestingly, you talked about engaging the communities, because if we don't engage the communities, we're going to have a huge problem. You know, cultural barriers are massive, it's not just restricted to South America. Certainly in Africa, cultural barriers prevent women from attending natal clinics, pre- and postnatal clinics, from having assisted child delivery. And so you have to get the local community into engaged in this. And we have done that. I'll give you one example. We've done a partnership with Accenture, with AMREV, to train community health volunteers. So these are not midwives. These are not people who are professionally trained. And we've used the mobile phone to train them. Most of them are actually illiterate, but they are trusted in the community. And so we've used voice, because you don't need to have a smartphone, you don't need to have a laptop to do this. We use voice, and we have a virtual classroom. So you have 10, 15 people joining a class at the same time, wherever they happen to be, listening using a cheap $10 phone, effectively. And we've enabled those people to go help drive the message. And of course, we use some of the technical solutions we have from partners like Philips, from partners like Farm Access, and I know we've got some Farm Access guys in the room today, to help to bolt that together. But it's actually quite difficult, and the difficult part is not the technology. Mm-hmm. The difficult part is learning how to work with each other, because you've got some big players who think they know all the answers, including us. We think we've got all the answers. Government think they've got all the answers. And putting that together, it's really, really tough.
I couldn't agree more. I spent a lot of time working in the digital field before I joined Politico, and it was never the technology that was the problem. It was always the people. But I think there's been a lot of examples of hope from the stage so far. But speaking of trying to understand and trying to answer questions, why don't we turn to one of the questions that is in the app? So I'm thinking perhaps we should go to question two. So we're going to bring up that question on the screen. But for those of you who have the app on your phone, you should go into the app now. And in the left-hand column, you go to the polling section. And if you go to question two, the question is, what is the hardest part of sustainable healthcare for all by 2030? And we give you about 15 seconds or so to make an answer. And then we'll get some reactions from everyone up on the stage. Uh-huh. I think we've got a winner. I'm not sure if our panelists, you can see it down in front of you there. So it was one of those funny questions that always tricked me in my English language tests at school. It was more about deciphering the sentence sometimes than answering the question. But out of that statement, sustainable healthcare for all by 2030, 77% of you thought for all was the hardest part to achieve. The sustainable part is much easier, and the by 2030 is much easier, but making sure it's for everyone is the hardest part. Are there any reactions up here on the stage? Does that concur with your thoughts on the question? Marta?
Yes, I was thinking, of course, for all, and you would not be surprised because I was talking about the most marginalized communities. So I wanted just to share. Can I share another example?
Yeah, of course. Examples are great.
Because in my previous intervention, I focused about what we always think about, and it's those who need the health care. But I wanted to share that we have to look both sides, on the demand side, but also on the delivery side. And I wanted to share with you another example, and this time it's in Bihar, in India. which is the most one of the most populated regions in India, and very, very poor. And here, our focus was on something that perhaps we don't think so easily, and it's who is responding. So many of the respondents in this, and the health, those who provide the health care, are women, very poor, from the communities, who don't have the right equipment, don't have the skills, and especially they are not valued. They are not, you know, stimulated, and they don't feel that they play a very good role. And this affects not only motivation, but performance. So one of the things that we did, and this is talking about partnerships, was taking practices from the private sector, and in particular, the team, to have team-based goals and incentives. So we work with these groups of women. Actually, they were, you know, different teams. They didn't connect, and work with them using these business techniques so that they could identify common goals and targets and measure against that. And they started actually to perform better. And we also had some systems of reward, like certificates that were recognized publicly. And they started to feel more valued, to perform better. And actually what we saw was that the impact on that in terms of the actual delivery of service was huge. So how to we were challenged at the beginning by our keynote speaker about how to scale up this. And I didn't mention for Peru, so it's how to. So get it into the norms and work with in partnership with the government so that these type of practices can be scaled up. So in Bihar, we are working with the government to try to put this type of very simple measures and to try to scale it up. So Bihar is 104 million people. So what we are seeing is that by empowering also these service deliverers, we are having real impacts. For example, just to give you an example, the frequency of visits in the first week when a woman gives birth has passed from 6% to 26%, just doing that. So you can imagine if this is scaled up, we are not only going to, again, empower women, and they will have more access to economic opportunities as well, but the results that we get in the health system are huge. So I think that doing that, both in the service providing and also in the demand side, we can, I think, have better chances to reach all.
Thank you.
Please jump in.
I would add a couple pieces of that, and I would look at from a systems piece and a human piece. So if you look at it from a systems piece, we're actually getting pretty good at systems for cities. It's actually the systems, the procurement systems, the supply systems, the human resource systems, getting it out to every community is the tough part. And that's the tricky part, because if you look globally, we're seeing increased wealth, which allows for some sustainability, but we're seeing gross increases in inequality. And that's in every country. It's not just in low and middle income countries, it's in all countries. So from a systems piece, the systems have to be built to get to the last mile. And that's something we're incredibly focused on. We have a new procurement mechanism online called wambo.org, massive innovation and immediate access to the lowest price, access for all. But we have to do it for supply chain. We have to do it for human beings, because we keep trying to get doctors and nurses out to rural communities. That's not going to work, and we probably don't need them. That's not how we responded to Ebola. We need communities, and we can do it from a systems piece. From a human piece, we are increasingly marginalizing people, and we made progress in human rights, but now we're going backwards on them. And whether it's gender or the traditional key populations, we're getting backwards on them. But I will give you an optimism around two of them. First is on the systems piece. We actually have a focus now on getting the systems out. And we talk about the Ebola states. We talk about the ones that failed. Let's look at the ones that succeeded, because there were 10 or 15 countries that actually either controlled immediately or prevented transmission across their borders. And how did they do it? They took community workers that were there mostly for malaria and vaccines and other purposes and stuck them along the borders. Cote d'Ivoire was a great example. They took all their community health workers, put them on the border, and they blocked transmission. Senegal, they used the malaria workers that were going house to house to look for fever for malaria, to look for fever for Ebola. So the systems can be functional if you focus on the community and if you focus on who is the right delivery provider and who can manage data at the local level, to the regional level, to the national level, to the global level, not wait for some big systems response. And it's empowering those communities and at each level. And Ethiopia's done it well, Rwanda's done it well, Kenya's starting to work on it, Malawi's done it. So there are great examples of what can happen from a systems piece. From a human rights piece, you know, some people look at the high-level meeting last week on HIV/AIDS, and Minister Plumman's absolutely right that it was that there were pieces there that were disappointing. But it was fascinating in public sessions I was in with ministers of health from some of the countries. They said, I don't know what's wrong with our perm reps because they're not representing what we do in our countries. Yeah. So we do sexual and reproductive health. We have programs for the LGBTI community. We're increasingly doing this. So we have to start telling the people who are negotiating these public documents that that doesn't represent who we are and what we're doing. And it's the youth that are actually going to change this. So there's a massive youth bulge coming in the world. Huge, huge, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa. And one exciting thing, one dangerous thing about that is we can see a massive increase in infectious diseases and birth rates and other things. But the opportunity is if we get this right, if we get the human rights piece, if we get the human piece right, if we get the human piece right, instead of taking 3, 4, 5 generations to change culture, you can change it in one generation because it will be the majority of the population. So if we focus now on these issues, if we work with youth, if we get the culture right now, we can actually have that rapid acceleration towards a world where we do reach all. And that's the exciting moment, but we could mess it up pretty badly if we look inward and backward.
Mm-hmm. Christian, and we then everyone can get the chance to respond, but I think you wanted to jump in.
Well,
there.
Thank you. Actually, I would have chosen for C because, okay. And not for all, because I think one of the lessons we can learn from the MDGs is that we can be quite successful. I mean, Mark knows much better the data than I, but if you see how far we've come with polio, with other diseases, to nearly eradicate them, and I think so. One of the big factors behind this success is innovation. And that's, I would link to what Ronald Young was saying. I think if we need more investment in innovation, because let's say the development sector and the humanitarian sector especially, you were referring to the Dutch Humanitarian Innovation Coalition, which I think is a good example. The development sector is not very innovative. Mm-hmm. I think an average company will spend 10% or more on research and development, and in our sector it's only a few percent, and in the humanitarian sector it's only less than 1%. And actually this is quite logic. I mean, people are so much concerned in the day-to-day delivery of helping poor people, of delivering of services. So there's not much focus on and money put away for investing in innovation. And I really welcome what Mark said. They created the Innovation Hub. I have to add maybe that one of the other things Ronald Young was mentioning, that you can only do this innovation if you use the knowledge of partners who have a very much bigger drive to innovate, which are companies, and then we'll get to the public-private partnership principle again, and that governments have an important role to take away the risk. We, for instance, develop so-called product development partnerships, where we really worked on research on neglected diseases, where let's say private companies were not really ready to invest in, where the government would take away the biggest risk. Not easy. I mean, it's a nice thing to talk about public-private partnership, but we've learned, at least from the government point of view, we have really different languages, we really have a different culture, so it takes time, but it's the only way. If we want to have innovation, and innovation is crucial to reach sustainable development goals.
Yeah. Elsa, and then Martin, sorry.
Right, so picking up on what Martha and Mark previously mentioned, I speak as a young woman from sub-Saharan Africa. So the statistics really deeply trouble me when I look at the fact that 2.1 million adolescents are living with HIV/AIDS, 64% of them are women and girls. 1 in 3 women are still sexually abused, either via violence. So now, from personal experience, I worked with the Society of Women Living with AIDS in Africa in 3 of the most socioeconomically deprived regions in northern Ghana, Wa, Tamale, and Borgatanga. Now, while on this internship or voluntary work, as you may call it, which a lot of the youth have decided that that is the one main area in which we can get involved in, is that I noticed firsthand at a lot of the ART centers, 80% of the population were women and girls. And I mean, amongst the myriad of questions I posed myself, that which stood out most was, where are the men? And I mean, it's an obvious question, but when you see the reality, it changes really how you think about things. And one of the programs which I was involved in was creating education to the women and girls on a grassroots level. Now, when we talk about going back to basics, be it human rights or a systems approach, we need to educate the women and the girls, not only at an urban level, but also on a rural level. Because you had a lot of the women who experience these issues, but they don't have the lack basic literacy skills. So it was trying to come down to the grassroots level and explain to them, i.e. via through either pictures or through synopsis or actions to try to explain to them and understand the infection process and the treatment process and also how to, you know, protect themselves and also defy the social and cultural norms. So this is one thing which really comes back to me to think, at the end of the day, as long as the women and the girls are not empowered and not educated, not only at an institutional level, not only at a university level, but really on the grassroots level, reaching out to all the rural areas and to all the health of the healthcare affected regions, which end up being a lot of the regions that are not particularly literate, and as long as the men, we don't ensure that the men get tested and actually own up and are accountable to their actions, then really we're not going to stop this this infection process, and we're not going to actually achieve the sustainable development goals of healthcare by 2030. But also picking up on partnerships, one of the things that also stands out most to me is how do we really get to a position where we're actually getting mutual beneficial partnership, and we're moving away from this donor-recipient partnership to making sure that both partners have equal power and that there is trust within both powers, and there's actually a space to, you know, disagree with specific partnerships but not be cut off because you have disagreed with per se what has been proposed.
Thanks. Martin.
Well, I'm utterly convinced it's the all part which will be the most challenging, because the other two largely depend on organization and resources. If we organize ourselves and we put enough resources, we can achieve those. The all part is challenging for three reasons. First of all, it requires that we work across sectors, particularly the link, and we're realizing this also in Europe, past year certainly, the link, for example, between the health and the social sphere. You cannot address some of the long-standing issues without also having synergies and coherence in social policy, in education policy, in gender issues. And I'll give you a concrete example. We're looking at the moment in Europe on the major communicable diseases. We still have significant problems with diseases like TB in Europe, for example. One of the highest incidences in Europe, for example, is among prisoners. Now, these are completely out of reach of the health system as such. They're in the justice system. So how do you work with the justice system to resolve a problem, knowing that there is a lot of turnover, prisoners, people moving in and out of the prison system, and this is one of the major contributors to the flow. How do you deal with, for example, refugees, migrants, etc., some of which might be outside the reach of health systems or at least undocumented? So the first reason. Second reason is, and let's not have any illusions about this, to go from aspirations to reality, in between there are political choices. And political choices are where it gets very difficult. Our experience in Europe has been that healthcare is really the most important form of redistribution of social justice there is. But this is not a principle that is universally shared globally. Let's be very honest about that. And also sometimes, even here in Europe, when you talk about things like, for example, refugees, migrants, etc., you get immediately into a very delicate area where there are very strongly held views for many reasons I won't go into. But clearly, this is absolutely so. Those political choices, and there are also sometimes a lot in health systems, a lot of vested interests everywhere, which obviously need to be addressed. And having, you know, health systems as a center does not mean that we should always defend entrenched practices. And the third reason why it's so challenging is the fact that you also, on the receiving side, we have to pay greater attention globally to health literacy. And because whatever the health system tries to do, if it does not fall on fertile ground, if there isn't the empowerment of people, this success will be very limited at best. And we have still a long way to go everywhere, and no region is literate on issues of health literacy. And increasingly, I mean, the new technologies are excellent and they have certainly great potential, but one thing they do imply is that individuals will have to take a more active role in managing their own health, because this is what it's all about. It's empowering people. You give them the means, but then they have to be able to use them properly and connect with others and seek information, seek expertise, etc., and follow up on the advice given. And if the health literacy aspect is not dealt with, then this thing will not happen. And that's why I think this issue, this part of the whole equation, is the most difficult to achieve.
Before we move to audience questions, Bob, did you have any reactions you wanted to throw in?
I could probably have a contrary view, actually, and say
please.
That, only because I like to be contrarian, that sustainable could be the problem. Mm-hmm. You could reach the all in a very short space of time. And why is sustainable a problem? Because if we don't articulate the business case for the private sector player, then it will come and go, and it will depend a lot on the current leadership. So when the CEO of Safaricom changes, then you could lose interest in it because it hasn't been framed in the context of a market and a business case. I come back to the complexities of managing some of those relationships which, you know, if it goes beyond four, it becomes really complex to hold it together. If we don't deal with the issues of education and personal ownership, which is not that easy at the tail end of it, if you like, then it's not going to be sustainable. And also, we all like to do pilots, you know, and we can have more pilots than the airline industry sometimes. And you know, I get very frustrated when we say, let's run another pilot, and then what? Well, the pilot actually gives you the PR opportunity. And when you know, how do you go beyond that? So there is a risk that the sustainable part could be the most difficult, because we can actually hit all in less than 15 years.
Yep.
But it might not be sustainable.
We've actually had some sustainable contributions on that point, through the Twitter responses that people have had. And if I can throw one of my own in, which is that, yes, there's a youth bulge, there's a chance to switch attitudes and systems in one generation, but those young people also get old, and what Europe has been especially bad at is planning for those young people getting old. So its own systems are not as sustainable as they might be. That leads to some of the points people were making on Twitter, which was that now people are facing choices, and not always making the ones that people in this room would agree with, between funding their own pensions and healthcare at home in developed countries versus their global responsibilities. And then one of the very politically sensitive points that I know has been spoken about here, Winnie from Oxfam was mentioning it to me yesterday, and we probably can't dive into it on the stage because we'll be here forever, is some of those EU-related policies that are coming up now, which tie things like aid money to stemming migration flows into Europe and so on. And so that is clearly something that brings into question some of the sustainability of all of those relationships and systems. But that's a bigger fish than we can fry today. How about I dive into one of your questions? Who has got a question for the panel? Yes, sir. I think, I'm not sure if we get a microphone to you or not. Shout it out if you can. Okay. Sorry, a mic is coming so that we can interpret you.
Excuse me.
Sorry.
Thank you very much.
My apologies.
Thank you very much, Jean-Jacques Schul from ID International, who is active fighting malaria with Artemisia annua in Africa. We could very easily eradicate malaria with this plant, but this is based on traditional medicine. Most Africans treat diseases with plants. They are accustomed to this, and this would be very cheap. The high technologies that are being proposed, we see it in malaria, it would cost, according to WHO, about 6 to 7 billion per year to eradicate malaria. With traditional medicine, it could be done very cheaply. Why are these people not having a chance to speak on these sort of panels? And what are the views of the panel members on this? Thank you.
Okay, who would like to jump in there?
You're a doctor.
I can do it briefly, in part because before I became a bureaucrat, I was a scientist. And artemisinin is a great example of a success. We've seen a lot of failures, and actually we've seen a lot of bad health outcomes because people go to traditional healers and get really bad stuff that doesn't help at all, and then they go away from medicines that can help them. But I do think what's exciting is there's a very active, whether it's publicly funded organizations like the US National Institutes of Health, or ANRS, or China, or Brazil, that are putting massive amounts of money into screening traditional medicines for things that could work. And artemisinin is a great example. But we have to be careful not to go too far in the direction of traditional medicine, because we saw a lot of people die in Africa, and still do, because they're going to traditional approaches rather than medically sound approaches. But we can't eliminate malaria. We need to make sure we do it before artemisinin becomes resistant, before we have too much artemisinin resistance. But I do think there's opportunity with traditional compounds. We just need to make sure they're actually medically sound.
Okay. Unless there's an urgent intervention, I've got another question online, which is around the role of prevention. Obviously, that can be a lot cheaper and more successful than a cure, but how do you make prevention happen? What do you see as the role of prevention in us getting towards this goal? Please, Martin.
Well, again, something we're really struggling hard with also in Europe. So we're having to learn by experience. First of all, key question is, how do you make prevention attractive to invest in? Because I think everybody agrees prevention, is really the way forward. But at the same time, I don't think we've been successful in transforming it into, concrete, for example, products, services. How could you get the interest, for example, of the private sector in prevention? A big issue. Because the interest of the private sector in curative approach, in treatments, is clear, it's evident. But in prevention, the business model has not yet been established. We need to do that. We also need to ensure that we shift our health systems. I mean, even in Europe, we have health systems that are still largely based on the needs of the 1950s. So you wait for people to get sick, and then you try to cure them at great cost. That has not taken into account the demographic shift, the nature of the chronic disease problem, but still, again, because of the rigid structure of these systems, and sometimes, let's also be honest, the very substantial interests on all sides, nothing moves forward. So prevention, I think, is one of those concepts which is proving to be difficult, also because, and this, I think, is maybe the most important difficulty to recognize, is that a lot of key elements of prevention are, again, outside the health sector. If you talk about taxation, if you talk about incentives, if you talk about communication, you talk about education, these are not the remit of the health ministries. And health has become, over the years, compartmentalized and sometimes over-medicalized. It's seen as kind of just a scientific sphere for doctors and other health professionals without the input of other important actors. And you cannot have prevention without, for example, education, without looking at economic incentives and disincentives to shift behavior. This is an illusion to think that this could happen. So how do you get health in all policies? How do you get also the other policies to think of themselves as also ministries of health? And that's the big challenge. That's why we are failing.
I'm seeing a lot of nods on the stage. Elsa or anyone else, would you like to jump in?
What I'd like to capitalize on is really a change of mindset, which moving on from the prevention mindset, from the treatment mindset to the prevention mindset, because that's all it is, a shift in thinking that you can get more from treatment rather than prevention. Because at the end of the day, as long as it's easier actually to prevent an outbreak or to prevent a disease than to actually treat it. And we obviously saw that within the cases of Ebola. But then, like he mentioned, it's outside the remit of the health system, because then we have to go into education, we have to go into capacity building, we have to go into strengthening. So when we're developing community workers on how to respond, we should also institute or make sure that it's capitalized on, that you're not only trained to respond, but you're also trained to make sure that you don't have to get that.
If I could just... This treatment prevention debate is actually, I think, wrong. the goal is ending an epidemic. It doesn't matter what it is. HIV, TB, malaria, Ebola, smallpox, doesn't matter what it is. It's ending an epidemic. And that's a different mindset than let's scale up treatment or let's scale up prevention. It's actually how do you put the pieces together to end an epidemic? And that means you have to do the right thing. So in the reality is treatment for communicable diseases is contributes to prevention. It's not sufficient, but it contributes in a significant way to prevention because if people aren't carrying disease, you actually can't transfer the disease. But it's not sufficient. If you read Bill, we've only eradicated one disease. We've only eliminated one infectious disease. Well, rinderpest, but that was a zoonotic disease. We've only eliminated smallpox, and we're going to get there on polio. If you read books, you know, Bill Foege's House on Fire, there was more stuff culturally in there than scientifically. So we need the innovations, we need the tools, but then you actually have to focus on how do you end an epidemic? How do you get to the cultural barriers? And certainly for HIV and TB, it's actually cultural. These are societal diseases. They're not just medical diseases. But you have to get into the community, and that's where the stuff that Philips is working on and Farm Access is working on, Safaricom is working on. You have to put all the pieces together, but we have to change the mindset from let's increase treatment or let's increase prevention to let's end an epidemic. And what does it take to end an epidemic from every sector, from everyone being engaged, and put those pieces into place, and then you actually end epidemics. And we have always struggled with that. Every time we've tried to shift to ending an epidemic, we get stuck in, is it prevention, is it treatment, is it care, how do we do this? How to just focus on ending an epidemic and to put the right places in.
Marta.
Well, I think that what I mentioned in my interventions address the root causes of many of the health problems, which are related with poverty, with inequity, with a lack of access for many discriminated populations. So one way of preventing is also addressing these deep causes of poverty and empowering women and addressing the social norms and attitudes. And I wanted to mention also a particular case because there are some places in the world where this is more acute. And you mentioned the issue of refugees, and I thought, of course, in humanitarian relief and emergencies. And it's quite striking that half of all the maternal deaths and of children under five happen in conflict and emergency contexts. So of the 10 worst countries in terms of maternal mortality, 9 are in fragile states. So if we are to prevent and get health for all, also looking at this particular context where these inequalities and this lack of access and rights are the worst, by addressing them, I think that we can do also a better job in terms of preventing and responding in the best way. And you mentioned the EU policies. Well, and we also heard from Mark that this need to integrate and to work across policies and sectors is so key. And I wanted to mention here, of course, the newly adopted gender action plan of the EU, which is absolutely key and needs to be taken into account when we think about health as well. And we have another great opportunity with the midterm review of the multi-annual financial framework. So how can we, in these type of frameworks, integrate all these concepts?
Thank you. Any more contributions? Sorry, Christian.
Well, maybe I'd like to echo both what Marta and Mark said on it's not just, let's say, you were mentioning diseases we're focusing, they are discriminating against poor people. Mm-hmm. And I also would advise you to read this article of my minister in The Guardian, which is really showing that if we can't fight inequality, we're never able to, let's say, to solve some of these diseases. And the second thing I want to mention is that we as an international community, we've been massively invested in vaccinations. I mean, that's been a very big way of prevention. Yeah. And both, I think, the Global Alliance for Vaccination Immunization is an excellent example where public and private parties work together. It's an excellent example of a partnership on scale with big impact on many of these diseases. And I think those are really good examples of where it had worked.
Excellent. We've got just under 10 minutes to go, so let's take two more questions. These two women who are one in the middle and one at the back. Yeah. Sorry. And we will take both the questions and then let the panelists respond. So yes.
Yeah, thank you. I'm Masha from the European Public Health Alliance. I have a question to
To Marta, I found it very striking, your example of caring for disadvantaged communities and working with women in Peru. I just returned from the most of the poorest regions in Europe, working with Roma health mediators in Bulgaria. And the examples that you give, how you do interventions, is very striking because we see a lot of parallels. And I think in that respect, we should work much more on a global level in terms of exchanging those practices that we have. My question is that you mentioned two things which are also very important for us, are the barriers, systemic barriers that should be addressed, as well as the social and cultural norms, and that it has to work in parallel, and I see it's also mutually reinforcing. From the experience that I just had, we're trying our best to address systemic barriers, and it requires a huge dose of political will on the ground, which is not always easy in Central Eastern Europe. But when we ask the health mediators, what are the biggest challenges for you in your work, they very often resorted to the social and cultural norms that are very hard to come over, and in terms of also sequencing the right interventions. So what would be your advice? And to give you the example, the biggest example was related to teenage pregnancies and girls getting married between the age of 11 and 14. What would be your advice, how to sequence things, how to overcome this? Because also in the social, in this normative realm, there are also vested interests from outside that we have to encounter. If you have any advice and any best practice on that, it would be very good. Thank
and
you.
Just before Marta answers, we take the final question up here.
Thank you, Ryan, and thank you, panelists. My name is Karen Hain. I'm an independent consultant who conducts research on development finance and health and development. And my question is about the recent shift in development finance taking place among most European bilateral donors. A small shift away from classic ODA approaches towards principally debt financing of government and commercial approaches to development finance. This is taking place in France, it's taken place for some time in Germany and Sweden and Netherlands, Denmark, the UK. Many, many, many European bilateral donors are making this shift. But debt financing of health and development is challenging because most health costs are current operational recurring costs. And so debt financing of operational costs is ill-advised under any public sector financial management set of principles. My question is, do you see decision makers addressing this issue in their more private discussions of these issues? Because we don't see much public discussion of that, nor do we see much investigation into the ultimate outcome implications of increasing development finance for health through debt. Thank you.
So, Marta, if you could react to the first question and then quick responses to Karen's question.
Yes,
that.
No, thank you for that. And I appreciate the challenges that we are finding. Well, we have developed all these years methodologies to try to where to start. So there is a particular one called the social analysis and action methodology, which is a rights-based approach. And basically, it consists of creating spaces for dialogue with the communities where we explore gender relations, power relations, in a way where we can create a safe space for dialogue. And sometimes to get into that ability to speak and to allow people to speak, we can get an entry point, for example, in something that we call the VSLAs, which is a system of saving by women. So they start to save and they start to lend among ourselves, and this creates, you know, like a cohesion. This is an example. But then it's using different ways of creating a dialogue and identifying which are the key barriers. And I will just very briefly mention one because it's very telling. In many places, the issue is, or the best way to approach is not working with women, but with men. So, for example, in cases of violence, so working, and we have examples in the Balkans, in Burundi, it's working with the men. In Burundi, men have now associated in groups that they are called those who bring the light. So it's for them to explore what is their understanding of masculinity. What does it mean to be a man? Many times men are violent because this is the way to be a man. So it's trying to understand these power dynamics, these social issues that are really embedded in the social tissue. And then by these dialogues, trying to identify which are the big or the places where we can make breakthrough, and then trying to work with them and engage the community as part of that, so that at the end, those who take the action are really them as part of the community.
Okay. We've got time for just a couple of quick reactions on the financing question. Is anyone who wants to jump in there? Christian, please.
Well, thank you. I think it's an excellent question. And you rightly pose this. I think this sometimes is a dilemma. I think one of the lessons learned on a more global scale is that we've been delivering too much debt. Which actually resulted in this whole debt crisis for many developing countries. And then we had to solve that again, as an international community. I think one of the lessons learned is that we have now more strict regulations, debt sustainability frameworks of the IMF to really look where we can. Should give ODA and where you should give and grant money, where you should give loans or debt or other forms of private flows. On the more national level, I think we have to do the same analysis. I just came from South Sudan this morning, and this is a country where, I mean, not many private investors would invest in, so there's a clear role for the public sector. And you have to see if you can make a business case. And if you can make a business case, why shouldn't we do it? Because it gives also some advantage in sense of, let's say, financial sustainability, bringing all knowledge. But sometimes the business case is not clear, and then you need public money. That's why we're talking about these public-private partnerships. To, let's say, take away the biggest risk, take away, because we have to, well, especially as you were rightly referring to, these recurrent costs are coming up, so you have to make a model which takes into account the nature of these costs.
Okay. I think I'm going to wrap it up there. We could go on for quite a while, and if anyone wants to send more... So I give the summary of the event now. Right, okay. That's why I have to wrap up. I knew there was a reason for this. So first of all, thanks to all of our panelists. And then just before I give a summary of what we've just discussed over the last 90 minutes or so, I'd also encourage you to rate the session on the app. If you go into the app, down at the bottom, you can give a 1 to 5-star rating about what you thought about the session so that we can all give better sessions to you next year at the European Development Days. Well, it's very difficult to summarize such a broad topic, but I think what came through very clearly to me was that we do need to have as many people involved as possible. We shouldn't prescribe precisely who is a legitimate actor in this discussion, and that you need to tackle it not just in very specific vertical ways. You can't say treatment versus prevention. It's as Mark said, you need to try and work to end all epidemics. You can't simply say that you have a disease-driven approach either if there are no systems that underlie that to help all of the great ideas and systems get from their small-scale successes that we've been hearing about in all of these different pilots, or the very big scale successes when it comes to specific conditions, as we've seen with malaria, as we are seeing more and more with HIV/AIDS. You obviously cannot separate from the issue of health literacy, from the issue of education, from the issue of having technologies that allow people to communicate. That really connects into that idea that we heard that health problems are not just a result of medical issues, they also have societal factors as well. I think that it was very clear that you cannot argue that a health outcome will be achieved unless you involve the community in designing the response to that health problem. That means that you also have to reflect that community. And one of the very clear messages that came through was the issue of having a gender equal world and having women in particular involved in designing those systems. We were very privileged to have a young leader on the stage with us today, and that's highly relevant in a continent like Africa with the youth bulge coming up. If you're not including the voices of those people who are going to use the system, drive the change to get us to that sustainable healthcare by all, it might also not work. I think that I heard very clearly as well that inequality is a growing problem. wealth gives you the resources to tackle the problems, but if there is a more unequal world, it's a lot harder to get to that last mile. It's a lot harder to make sure you get to the for all part of the sustainable development goal that we've all been discussing. 77% of you said that the for all part was going to be much harder than finding things that were sustainable or getting those things delivered by 2030. I think that I'm going to wrap it up there. One of the questions and thoughts that came in on Twitter that really stuck with me is that this requires a huge dose of political will. I think that's true. I think we have a lot of the technical and medical solutions out there. They work in the developed world right now. If we can just figure out how to work more with each other and to scale up and spread out some of those great ideas we've been hearing from panelists on the stage, then we're going to get much closer to that goal of sustainable healthcare for all by 2030. Thank you all for your participation, and I'll invite our panelists to stay on stage for a second to take a photo. And thank you very much, everybody.